So going through that roll call and hearing just how far our movement reaches is such a powerful reminder of the role that unions play in our country. Each one of you and each one of your unions has spent the past 2.5 years supporting members and their families through an incredibly challenging time. You've adapted to a global pandemic that has changed the ways we work and live. And through it all, you have kept our country running. You've provided urgent medical care. You've kept food on our tables. You've switched gear to manufacture PPE. And you've kept our transportation systems and our economy running. You have lifted up your members, your communities, and our country. But our movement also has experienced incredible loss over the past 2 years. Some have lost jobs. Some have lost homes. Many of us have lost loved ones. It is heartbreaking to acknowledge how many have lost their lives because of their jobs. Our union family experienced loss in a heartbreaking way, and for so many tied directly to the work we do. We think of meatpacking and food processing, transit and transportation workers, postal workers, grocery workers, nurses, and EMTs, and so many others, educators, who faced incredible risks and suffered disproportionate loss of life. And in just the last 18 months, we've faced heartbreak as our labor movement lost two giants, our friends and our fearless leaders, Rich Trumka and John Sweeney. At the memorial for John in May and the memorial for Rich just last night, it was clear how beloved they both were and how deeply their losses are felt across our federation and across our country. And I want to recognize Barbara and Rich Jr., who are here with us today. We are honoring all those we've lost at our memorial wall in the exhibit hall. It's a place where we welcome you to celebrate the lives of those we've lost to COVID, as well as John Sweeney and Rich Trumka, and all of our union siblings who have passed on since our last convention. And now, please join me for a moment of silence to remember all those who we have lost over the past 5 years. Thank you. Our movement has led the way through this pandemic, and I'd like to shine a spotlight on some of the heroes, our members, who stepped up to keep our hospitals running, our grocery stores stocked, ramped up PPE production to meet urgent demand, and kept our schools and communities running while so many sheltered at home. Please join me in welcoming our own frontline heroes who gave new meaning to the word essential. Start again. The mic wasn't on. Her mic's not working.
Testing.
There we go.
All right. My name is Mary Turner. I'm an ICU nurse and I'm honored to be the president of the Minnesota Nurses Association, an affiliate of National Nurses United. Since the very start of the pandemic, I have worked in a COVID ICU in my hospital. Throughout this pandemic, our union has had to fight like hell to get the protections we've needed. I remember at the start of the pandemic, I felt this rush of anger when I walked onto the floor and the younger nurses came running up to me. "Mary, Mary, is it true that we get only one N95 and have to wear it till it disintegrates off our faces?" That's what our boss told us. I'll never forget the fear that I saw in those nurses' eyes. The sad thing is, we were luckier than others around the country. Some nurses had to make do with garbage bags substituting for gowns. As we fought for protection, there were many times I felt like we were just rowing into the winds, barely moving. I felt so helpless the night I cared for a fellow nurse who was fighting for his life on a ventilator after he got COVID out on the medical floor because the hospital refused to give those nurses any N95s. I felt heartbroken that as a nurse leader, I had not been able to shield him from the hospital's or our government's indifference to the value of his life. Thus far, 1.2 million nurses and other healthcare workers have been infected with COVID, and thousands have died because of this indifference. I was determined to make things better. Our union nurses reached out to the public and the press to protest. I did countless press interviews so everyone could see the injustice and no one could say they didn't know. And then in November of 2020, I had the chance to tell my story directly to Joe Biden, then the president-elect. He was so moved, he actually cried. For the first time, I finally felt like I was being heard. After President Biden took office, he appointed me to be on the Federal COVID-19 Health Equity Task Force. I was the only frontline worker on that task force. We union nurses keep putting pressure on the administration, demanding an OSHA emergency temporary standards to strengthen protections against COVID-19. And we were joined by the AFL-CIO and so many of the unions in this hall today in a powerful united front. And in June of 2021, the Biden administration issued that ETS, the first OSHA ETS since 1983. Mind you, there are lots of big moneyed interests fighting that standard, including the powerful hospital industry. But we nurses together with the rest of the labor movement prevailed for our patients. And now we're working together to make sure that OSHA issues a permanent COVID standard for all healthcare workers very soon. That is the power of collective action and solidarity, and that is why I'm so proud to be part of this network of unions in the AFL-CIO. Because I know when we work together, we win together, and we protect our communities together. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Sharon Santana. I am a teacher at Parkway Northwest High School in Philadelphia and a proud, proud member of Philadelphia Federation of Teachers Local 3. Nearly every child has been affected by the pandemic, and teachers, alongside many of you, have been standing at the front lines. We were tasked with caring for and educating America's children as well as our own. I will never forget a message I received from one of my graduating seniors. She said, "Thank you for helping me make it through. Without your help, I probably would not have made it this year." My student was not alone in her sentiments. Teachers made a huge impact. Teachers created new curriculum, and we pushed the boundaries of pedagogy to connect with our students in the virtual classroom. And when teachers returned to the classroom, we were met with disdain and contempt. Instead of resources and thoughtful safety protocols, I was required to teach in isolation to an empty classroom. And when the students returned to the classroom, I had to clean and sanitize my own room while listening to offensive memos about window fans as protection and ventilation. On top of all of that, we were forced to work under an expired contract, and we had to fight tooth and nail to receive the hard-earned contractual pay raises that we deserved. I was frustrated, I was exhausted, but instead of resigning, I fought back by becoming an advocate for my fellow educators and students. Woo! Funding from the American Rescue Act was an opportunity to right so much of the harm done to our young students and school communities. But so far, we have only seen cuts. Cuts to budgets, to resources, teachers, administrators. The only thing that we have seen is more overcrowded classrooms, more unqualified hires, and a complete lack of transparency. And it is our children who are suffering. Declining mental health, unprecedented murder rates, here in Philadelphia, unfathomable gun violence, students taking to the streets in protest, crying out for answers. The answer is simple. Invest in our schools, in our students, in our teachers, in a broad and comprehensive way. And most of all, we must continue to fight for funding for our schools, strong health and safety protocols, and workers' rights. I leave you in the words of one of our nation's first labor rights activists, the abolitionist William Lloyd Garrison. We are in earnest. We will not equivocate. We will not excuse. We will not retreat one single inch. And we will be heard. Thank you. Woo.
Hello, my name is Eric Coates from the ATU Local 26 in Detroit. I've been a bus operator for 6 years. At the very beginning of the pandemic, my coworker, Jason Hargrove, went viral, literally. He had posted a video on social media of how disgusted he was with a woman who openly coughed on the back of his bus without covering her mouth. 4 days later, Jason was diagnosed with COVID. And 10 days later, on April the 1st, 2020, he died. He was the first person of our local that we lost to COVID. He told me from his hospital bed that he loved me. He was my union brother and my best friend. Driving a public bus in normal times has always been a tough, dangerous job, and it's not a hygienic environment. In the pandemic, we have been working in what I call a 40-foot petri dish. We get the public going where they need to go, work, school, doctor's appointments. And buses are often used as shelter for people who don't have any. But the public takes out their frustrations on us too. When it came to the worker safety response against COVID, bus operators and transit workers weren't even a part of the equation. We were told we were essential, but we were treated like we were disposable. Our employers barely changed their policies to keep us safe. We had limited PPE, and we weren't trained. At the beginning, all they gave us for each shift was one hand wipe and one pair of rubber gloves. Eventually, they gave us a mask, even though we needed respirators. Some of us brought our own masks in because we weren't provided enough to get through our shifts. We have been trying to protect ourselves and our families from an invisible threat, even though that was our employer's job. So we fought for a work stoppage. We won one on March the 17th, 2020. It was my union, the ATU, that was pivotal in winning the transit shutdown that kept us out of harm's way when they wouldn't keep us safe. We needed to put the pressure on. Jason was also pivotal in winning that work stoppage before he died. It was my union, the ATU, that fought for and won protections for our members, including PPE, bus shields, better air filtration systems, rear door boarding, and more. We're still working in a 40-foot petri dish. COVID isn't over. My brother Jason fought for the rest of us and our unions to keep fighting for stronger safety policies at work, because all we deserve to go home at the end of the day unharmed. Thank you.
Nice.
All right, now, when I say AFL, y'all say CIO. AFL.
CIO.
AFL.
CIO.
AFL.
CIO.
AFL.
CIO.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone. My name is Cleon Williams. I work here in Philadelphia as a motor vehicle operator for the United States Postal Service, and I'm a proud member of the American Postal Workers Union. Even before COVID, postal workers were essential workers. But the pandemic highlighted just how important our work is to the country. Every day, we get up and help and keep people connected all day long. When so many other people stayed home, we went to work and made sure you could order your medicine and other essential supplies and know that they'd be there at your door in just a few days. I'm especially proud of the role we played in the 2020 election. With the pandemic raging, we knew even then more voters than usual would be voting by mail. The APWU, and the other postal unions forced postal management to work with our unions to make sure vote mail and vote by mail was a success. We had election mail task force in every facility. I said every facility, making sure no ballot was left behind and that election mail moved as quickly as possible. I was proud to serve on one of those election mail teams. And in the end, we delivered more than 65 million ballots. 65 million ballots. And the pandemic election, with the record number of people relying on the Postal Service to vote, was a success. A success. I'm a proud postal worker. I'm a proud union member. And I'm proud of the essential and public services my sisters and brothers do every day. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Ukubaini ubarkin margibero odo. I just welcome you in my mom language called Zarma. My name is Aisha Tairu. I'm from Niger, West Africa. I'm a housekeeper at the Warwick Hotel here in Philadelphia. And a proud UNAD here union member. During the peak of the pandemic, I was laid off along with 98% of other UNA here, hotel and hospitality workers across the country. It was a difficult year, but during the hardest part of the pandemic, the union was with me, giving me support. The union gave me a place to be who I am, to raise my voice. I used this time to canvass in Philly to elect Joe Biden as president. Then I went to Georgia and knocked on doors for the Senate runoff to take back our democracy. We won, but I knew the fight was not over. Since they reopened, the hotels, they don't want to bring people like me back to work. And they are cutting services like daily housekeeping, so they don't have to bring us back. But as union, we took them on so that women like me have a chance to be on our feet again. am on leave of absence, canvassing for the midterms in Philadelphia. As black woman, as an African immigrant, it's important for me to fight for my rights. I'm powerful, and I have a voice to make a difference for workers in this city and across the country. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Claire Heinrichs, and I have been a proud member of UFCW Local 360 for 43 years, a shop steward for 25 years. Woo! I have also worked for Acme Markets for 43 years, and I'm currently working in Logan Township, New Jersey store. I never thought that something like COVID-19 could happen here in the United States. In those very uncertain times of COVID, we were all forced out of our comfort zone. My coworkers and I were constantly being approached by the customer who had high anxiety from the uncertainty of not finding the essential food items. Many of them did not start wearing masks until it was mandated and disrespected the social distance guidelines, which made us really uncomfortable and feel unsafe. I'm going to add a personal story here. I work at a little coffee shop. It's a Starbucks, but it's in Acme Markets, and I'm an Acme employee. A customer came in, and we were told if they didn't have masks, we were not allowed to serve them. I explained kindly to the customer. He got very irate. I got a coffee filter. I gave it to him to cover his face. He got very irate with me and threw it at me. These are just some of the little things that we've had to deal with. We all had to face our fears to deal with. We all shared the same fear of bringing this virus home to all of our loved ones. A lot of my coworkers were so afraid of the virus that they chose to take a leave of absence or just not to stay home. UFCW Local 360 reacted swiftly and proactively to protect us. Shields were installed at the registers and the courtesy counters. Lower store capacities of customers at one time were set in all stores, and we received temporary hazard pay of $2 an hour. Union shop steward conference calls were held weekly where employees were able to voice their concern and their fears regarding their safety and their health issues. UFCW Local 360 was able to get answers to these questions and were able to make us feel more at ease. UFCW Local 360 has never impressed me more than how they advocated for its members during these trying times. We would all like to thank the UFCW Local 360 for their support. I would also like to thank the AFL-CIO for giving me the opportunity to speak on behalf of the essential workers from the UFCW.
Nice.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. My name is Edward Ditzel, Jr. I'm a proud member of Branch 157 of the National Association of Letter Carriers. I'm honored. That's right, NALC! I'm honored to stand here with these, among these everyday heroes of the pandemic. Of course, we all know that workers like us were essential long before COVID struck. I have served as a letter carrier here in Philadelphia for 32 years. Along with our brothers and sisters, the American Postal Workers Union and National Mail Handlers Union, letter carriers have helped connect and strengthen our nation's 160 million households and businesses 7 days a week. During the COVID crisis, we have helped tens of millions of Americans work from home, shelter in place, and stay safe by delivering billions of packages, distributed relief checks from the Treasury, health bulletins from the CDC, and COVID tests from the Department of Health and Human Services. And we made it possible for half of the country's 160 million voters to safely vote by mail in 2020 in the highest turnout and fraud-free election in our lifetime. time. All this in the middle of a global public health crisis. Thousands of postal employees have tested positive for COVID, and tens of thousands have had to quarantine over the past 2 years. Sadly, the virus killed several hundred of our members, mostly in the early months of the pandemic. But thanks to our unions, we have a place at the table and voice on the job. NALC and our sister unions worked around the clock to secure adequate supplies of PPE, negotiate liberal leave policies, and reorganize our workspace to minimize the risk of infection. Thanks to our unions, we've been able to do what union workers always do, deliver for America.
All right. Go, Ron.
Let's go, Ron. Bring it home. Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. I'm Ron Herrera, president of the Los Angeles County Federation of Labor. President Shuler, my brother Fred Redmond, and the entire executive board, thank you for the work that you all do to better the lives of working families in this country. The labor movement was built on the fundamental idea that we are stronger together. And when challenges or disasters arise, you can count on the labor movement to be on the front lines. When the COVID-19 pandemic hit, our membership in Los Angeles knew that this was the time not to hesitate. It was a time to act. It was a time to lead. We immediately coordinated food relief program in response to tens of thousands of laid off workers to aid our community. To date, we have fed over 800,000 individuals through our nonprofit Labor Community Services.
Wow.
When our economy was shut down, we help members navigate the process to access unemployment benefits and rental assistance. During the height of the pandemic, our office parking lot became a COVID testing site to thousands of community members. The Los Angeles labor movement delivered more than 3 million meals to more than 10,000 homebound seniors. We provided more than 1,000 jobs to laid-off hospitality workers and taxi drivers. Because in the labor movement, no one gets left behind. We closed down our testing site and converted our parking lot into a vaccination center where we have vaccinated and boosted thousands of community people. Our newest endeavor has now expanded the reach of that program and turned it into the People's Project, a new kind of mutual aid network that empowers communities through mutual cooperation and reciprocation. This program will engage with 2 million Angelenos by establishing a new organizing platform that trains our communities to be the first point of contact when the need arises, connects those in need to vital aid, and builds power through direct networks and community care. The People's Project has set out to become the largest mutual aid project in the history of Los Angeles County. LA Union, as we are called, has adapted to meet every new challenge and opportunity. When we saw one of our brothers or sisters needed a little extra help to get by, we were there. That is why we, in this movement, know that the future of labor is bright. Because even under the most unprecedented trying circumstances, we never stopped working for each other, we never stopped working for our communities, and we never stopped caring for one another. Thank you very much.